Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Scarvagh Street on Sunday, the 18th of October. Friends, this would traditionally be our Harvest Sunday, and although we can't give our thanks to God in our usual way, we do remember that God remembers us. And maybe appropriate that in our studies in Genesis, coming to chapter 8, we learn there of God remembering Noah. God is faithful, and we know we can ever trust him. So welcome to worship this Sunday morning. If you are able to tune in to the website on a Wednesday, you'll find our studies in Revelation continuing. So please do avail of those. If you can, I trust you'll find those helpful as we seek just to open up this pictorial book to us, this book of revealing that God has given at the end of the scriptures. Friends, we come to think of God remembering Noah today. And so we begin our worship as we sing, "Great is thy faithfulness." God is ever true, and we are ever in his debt. Let's lift our voices as we bring our praise to God.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. Thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Pardon for sin, and a peace that endureth. Thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father.
Friends, we come to the Lord in prayer. Let us pray. Father, we bless you that you are the God who remembers. You're the God who remembers your people especially. And Lord, down through the generations, as you have revealed yourself in the scriptures and beyond, we know and note your faithfulness. You remembered Noah to bring him out of the ark. You remembered David when he sinned against you. You remembered Esther in front of a pagan king. You remember Daniel and his friends in Babylon. You remember Jonah in the belly of a great fish. You remembered Peter, who had denied you. You remembered Paul, who fought against you. And in the scriptures, you declare your remembrance of all your people. You promise never to leave us nor forsake us. You promise to be with us to the very end of the age. And Lord, at this service of worship, we gladly remember you in turn, the faithful one. Lord, may our worship be acceptable to you. May you purify it in your Son, Jesus, that you might delight in all that we sing and say and think and how we respond to your word. Lord, let this be a hallowed hour. An hour when we meet with God, and in his mercy he meets with us. Father, you teach us when we pray to remember our sins as well. Sins of thought, sins of word, sins through what we have done or failed to do. Sins of false or vain ambition. Sins of the misuse of our time and our energies. Sins where we just don't think of you and look for you in life's circumstances. Lord, forgive us, we pray, and move by your Spirit in mind and heart, Lord, that we might be more aware of these things. Make us sensitive to the prompting of your Spirit, that our prayer of repentance will also be a prayer of action as we resolve to be more dedicated to you, O God. Hear our prayers for Jesus' sake. Amen. Friends, we find our reading in Genesis chapter 8, reading the first 19 verses. Genesis 8, reading from verse 1. But God remembered Noah and all the wild animals and the livestock that were with him in the ark. And he sent a wind over the earth, and the waters receded. Now the springs of the deep and the floodgates of the heavens had been closed, and the rain had stopped falling from the sky. The water receded steadily from the earth. At the end of the 150 days, the water had gone down. And on the 17th day of the 7th month, the ark came to rest on the mountains of Ararat. The waters continued to recede until the 10th month. And on the first day of the 10th month, the tops of the mountains became visible. After 40 days, Noah opened the window he had made in the ark and sent out a raven, and it kept flying back and forth until the water had dried up from the earth. Then he sent out a dove to see if the water had receded from the surface of the ground. But the dove could find no place to set its feet, because there was water over all the surface of the earth. So it returned to Noah in the ark. He reached out his hand and took the dove and brought it back to himself in the ark. He waited 7 more days and again sent out the dove from the ark. When the dove returned to him in the evening, there in its beak was a freshly plucked olive leaf. Then Noah knew that the water had receded from the earth. He waited 7 more days and sent the dove out again. But this time it did not return to him. By the first day of the first month of Noah's 601st year, the water had dried up from the earth. Noah then removed the covering from the ark and saw that the surface of the ground was dry. By the 27th day of the second month, the earth was completely dry. Then God said to Noah, "Come out of the ark, you and your wife, and your sons and their wives. Bring out every kind of living creature that is with you, the birds, the animals, and all the creatures that move along the ground, so that they can multiply on the earth and be fruitful and increase in number upon it." So Noah came out, together with his sons and his wife and his sons' wives. All the animals and all the creatures that move along the ground and all the birds, everything that moves on the earth came out of the ark, one kind after another. Amen. We thank God for the truth of his word. Boys and girls, we are thinking of the story of Noah in the early chapters of the book of Genesis. And last Sunday, I had a painting that my wife Kathy had done for me. And there's a picture of, well, it's meant to be Noah. You can see he's got his eyes covered with his hands and he's thinking. And as you can see the picture there, he's seeing a tree there with someone hanging onto the tree. There's someone in the water. There's a cow and there's a goat or a ram in the water. And the flood has come. Now Noah is thinking about this because God had promised to send a flood because the people on earth had got so wicked and God was going to start again with Noah, his wife, his sons, and their wives. God was going to come in a judgment that would be all over the earth. And there's never been a judgment since like the judgment of the flood. God had something to say. And what he said to Noah. And Noah knew just how serious this was going to be. And he just wasn't sure what he would make of what God had told him. But today, another picture, another painting. And I'm sure you can have an idea what this is. God has something to say to Noah, that Noah was to build an ark, a large boat. Now, there'd be no rain because the earth was watered by vapor just coming up from the ground. So there was no rain. The whole earth was covered by a big thick canopy of water, and that was the water that came down in the flood. So there'd never been any rain, and there was no sense of any water on the ground. And yet Noah built a boat. And the boat was so big, it was built on three levels, a bit like a very sort of long-shaped barge. And when you added the three levels together, it was about 4.5 football pitches. So you can imagine how big that was. And Noah was building the ark month after month, year after year. We're not sure exactly how long it took, but it took between maybe 55 and 75 years. And of course, when Noah came out of the ark, he was 600. And he was a very, very old man. But in all those years he built the ark, you can see someone there at the bottom of the painting. And I'm sure he was saying, what on earth is this man doing? Building a big structure? He's talking about a flood, but where's the water coming from? We just see a few wee streams along the ground, or we see mist coming up from the earth's surface. Where's all this water coming from? Noah heard what God had to say, and Noah chose to be God's servant. He was going to do exactly what God had asked him to do, even when he couldn't understand. And boys and girls, sometimes we are asked to do things by God. Whatever it may be, we're to turn the other cheek, we're to go the second mile, we're not to return evil for evil, we're to try and do what's right, we're to be very careful how we speak and how we live. We live in a world that's very different from this. And sometimes we find it very hard. But we want to be like Noah. We want to be God's servant. And just as Noah built the ark exactly how God asked him to build it, we want to live our lives exactly the way God asks us in his Bible. Let's remember this as we pray together. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for the way you looked after Noah. We thank you that you told him about the flood. You had something to say. And we thank you that Noah listened. and he believed you, even though he wasn't sure how this was going to happen. And we thank you that he became a servant, so faithful all those years, building the ark. Lord, help us to be like that. Help us to be faithful all the time. Help us to be faithful when we don't understand. Help us to be faithful when we have questions and we don't have any answers. Help us to look to you in your word and to seek to do what you ask us to do. Lord, make us special boys and girls who live for God and his Son, the Lord Jesus. Hear our prayer for Jesus' sake. Amen. Friends, as you know, each week from our central offices in Belfast, prayer requests are sent out to our congregations. And I just want to bring one or two of those to us today as we come to pray for others. In India, we have a number of partnerships with Christian groups in India, not of all of them Presbyterian, and that's not important, but we have partners in India from different denominations. And in India today, there are over 6 million cases of COVID-19. Of course, we know that in many parts of India, there is extreme poverty. And there is very poor medical resource. And many of the folk who have contracted this virus will have very little help in seeking to fight it. And of course, with the population of India and people living so closely together, the likelihood of this to spread is all the greater. We're asked to pray for the people of India. And also, unrelated to that, but equally important, India sadly has enacted an anti-conversion bill, a bill that makes it illegal to convert to Christianity. That's being tabled through the Indian Parliament. Now, we want to ask God that he will step in and that this won't become full-blown. Let's come to God as we pray for this and other things. Let's pray. Father, we bless you that you're the God who hears and answers our prayers. Not because we ask them, not because we are worthy, but because such is your promise and you are faithful. So, Lord, move us in heart as we pray, that we won't just think thoughts, we won't just mouth or say words, but, Lord, that you will be in the prayers that we offer. Lord, we remember the country of India today. Many millions of people teeming in the cities. We remember those who have contracted the virus and some from very poor backgrounds with little ability to have medical help. Lord, we pray that you will be their comfort and their peace. We pray for those who seek to reach out, that you will keep them safe. We remember medical staff and those who attend. We think of hospitals, much too full and much too busy. And Lord, remembering that each soul is important and precious. And Lord, overshadowing this, there's a desire in parts of the Parliament that Christianity be outlawed, that people are not allowed to convert to Christ alone. Lord, perhaps in such a day, when our own human frailty is so exposed, that by your Spirit you will breathe across this nation, and that many will have cause to think of Christ, perhaps hearing of him on the airwaves, or from someone speaking boldly in the street. Lord, protect your people, we pray, and make them a mouthpiece of God, and breathe by your Spirit, and touch needy lives and bring them to Christ. Father, we think too of our own country. We think of the times in which we live too. We pray that in your mercy, you'll conquer this virus in the power of your name. We pray, O God, that on an earthly level you will equip scientists to provide a vaccine, that you will be in their thinking and in their experimenting. And we pray, O God, that this will be effective in your time. And we pray, O God, as you will take this world out of this crisis, that hearts will be tender, hearts will be thankful, hearts will look to God, and you will pour out your Spirit again, and the world will know the name of Jesus. We pray for our own local medical teams. We pray for those who keep our food supply chains going. We pray for those who meet our daily needs in services. And Lord, we ask that we too will be thankful in heart, that we will remember the Lord, that we will be thankful for his blessing. We remember too those who are sick, those anxious, those needing operations or those awaiting operations, those needing to see a consultant, or those fearful of going out, those afraid of catching something that would bring their health down further. Lord, in all our frailties, we look to you and we pray your hand in mercy and blessing upon those very conscious of their need of God today. And Lord, be pleased to bless us in your word. As we open that word in a little while, come by your Spirit and be our teacher again, for Jesus' sake. Amen. Friends, Leah is going to come and lead us in worship as she brings a song of praise.
Empty handed. sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. 'Twas blind, but now I see. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Oh, I once was lost, but now I'm found. 'Twas blind, but now I see. Oh, I can see. Blind, but now I see.
Friends, as we come to God's word today, we think of Noah in the ark. Now, perhaps like me, from childhood, you were taught the story of Noah. And I suppose as a little child, you tend to think of the ark as a funny shaped boat with a wee turret and maybe a giraffe's head, neck and head sticking out from a window. But of course, the ark wasn't like that. It was the most stable structure possible, like a large barge unable to be turned over. We think today of God remembering Noah. I suppose it's easy just to read the verses and not really think about them, perhaps because we are relatively familiar with them. And yet, we ought always to try to place ourselves in the shoes of the other person. To place ourselves in Noah's shoes and to be on the ark with him. He had built the ark over all those years. And then the rains came. God was proving himself to be the faithful one. God had shut the door, and that door could not be opened. Noah knew that God was keeping him inside and keeping others outside. God was coming in judgment. But what did Noah think day by day, week by week, month by month, the rains falling and falling? And this enormous structure, this barge, floating on the surface. The skies were dark. The sun was not seen. The rains kept coming and coming. It was dark. And Noah was floating on the surface and beneath a world of death, a world that was no more. I wonder what went through his mind. Did Noah think, I'm a sinner? Why would God spare me? Am I going to die on this floating prison? Day by day, week by week, month by month, sitting, waiting. We learn that God remembered Noah. But how did God remember him? There are three things we find in this passage, and we can relate to the faithfulness of God remembering his servant Noah. But God remembered Noah in verse 1. And then we read in verse 3 and 4, the water receded steadily from the earth. At the end of the 150 days, the water had gone down. And on the 17th day of the 7th month, the ark came to rest on the mountains of Ararat. God was beginning to allow Noah to see that he, God, was faithful. The waters began to recede, and Noah began to see his hope being realized. Sometimes, don't we have to wait to find the God who remembers us? Day by day, Noah, we don't read of him questioning God or asking for answers or asking for God to give him a word. But no doubt that was in his mind. But he simply waited. And after all those months, God began to act. And the waters receded. And then in verse 11, we read the second sign that God gave to Noah. Noah had sent a dove out, and the dove couldn't find any resting place. But then we read in verse 11, when the dove returned to him in the evening, there was in its beak was a freshly plucked olive leaf. Noah knew that the water had receded from the earth. He waited 7 more days and sent the dove out again, and this time it did not return to him. And then there was a final thing that God revealed to Noah about his faithfulness. We read that in verse 16 and 17. Come out of the ark, you and your wife and your sons and their wives. Bring out every kind of living creature that is with you, the birds, the animals, all the creatures that move along the ground, so that they can multiply on the earth and be fruitful and increase in number upon it. God begins to speak again. The Lord spoke to Noah. Sometimes God gives us signs. Sometimes God will speak directly to us as we lift up his word, and as we seek to understand it, he can pierce our hearts, he can touch our minds. Sometimes God speaks to us through circumstance, through a Christian friend, or through something that has happened. And we need to be sensitive to the God who is faithful. God acted for Noah as the waters receded. He acted for Noah to let him see that there was dry land. And he acted for Noah by finally speaking. God remembers his people. I suppose in the day in which we live, when there is such confusion in our world, in this whole pandemic across the face of the earth, there is potential destruction everywhere. And sometimes people will say, well, where is God in all of this? If you had been on the ark with Noah and the whole world was dead beneath you, you may have been all the more tempted to say, where is God in all of this? And yet God is faithful. He is there. And God will give his signs just as he gave the signs to Noah. And God will bring his word to his people's hearts just as he did Noah. We are called to walk by faith, not by sight. But this is not a blind faith. It's a faith in the God who is faithful. Faith in the God who speaks. Faith in the God who orders circumstances for his glory and for the good of his people. And of course, because God remembered Noah, when Noah leaves the ark, the first thing he does, the very next verse from the verse we stopped at, he builds an altar. And he sacrifices to God. He takes the place of the sinner that he is, the sinner who needs forgiveness from God. And he approaches God in the way God had determined, through the sacrifice of another. We too, like Noah, when we see the faithfulness of God, the first thing we ought to do is to worship. We live in a world where worship is an added extra, if desired at all. But the first thing we ought to do always is to worship God. That's what makes Sunday particularly special. The first day of the week, the day for worship. And we are denied so much presently that ability to meet together as a gathered community to worship God. We can only meet a few of us with social distancing. But our worship is much more than a gathering together on the Lord's Day. Our worship is to be all of life. When we get up to remember our Lord, in the way we live and speak and act to remember our Lord, when we put our head on the pillow at night to remember our Lord, to be conscious that God is with us, his people. And in the scriptures, aren't we taught to remember God? Ecclesiastes 12, verse 1. Remember your Creator in the days of your youth. Children, young people, adolescents, to remember God, our Creator. When we are young, let that be our foundation, to seek God, to honor God, to rejoice in his laws, to glorify him in his world, to remember our Creator in the days of our youth. Jeremiah 51 verse 50 tells us to remember your God in a distant land. When we're away from home, or when our present circumstances don't feel like home and don't feel normal, such as the days in which we live. It's as if we're in an alien land. To remember our God in all circumstances. And Jonah, in Jonah chapter 2, verse 7, in the belly of that great fish, we read that he remembered the Lord when his life was ebbing away, and his prayers were rising up to the holy temple of the Lord. Remember God when you're young. Remember God in a distant land. Remember God as your life is ebbing away. And friends, as we seek to remember this God who remembers us, the God who remembered Noah, we will know his peace and his comfort. Our belief, our reverence, our desire for God will be rewarded. Friends, don't we have much to learn from Noah? He waited patiently for God. God gave him a sign. God confirmed that sign. And then God spoke. And Noah knew that he had been delivered. And as God had remembered him, so he remembered God. Let us be the same today. Let's pray. Father, we bless you for this word in Genesis. We bless you for its bleak and vivid picture. We read at the beginning of this wonderful Bible that things were dark. The water covered the surface of the earth, and the Spirit began to blow. And we see here in chapter 8 the same thing. The world was dark with the clouds of rain above. The earth again was covered in water. And the wind began to blow. You were starting again, O God. You had dealt a vital blow to the devil's plans in his desire to corrupt the human race. And you were starting with Noah and his wife and his sons and their wives again. And as they came out of the ark, they knew the deliverance of God and that his promise of faithfulness was true. Lord, let us learn from this, that when the skies above us are dark, when days are difficult and uncertain, when we wait and we don't hear any voice, that we will trust on because you, O God, are ever with your people. Your hand is ever upon them. Your grace is ever flowing. And when in time, whatever the darkness is, when we step out of the ark into the sunshine again, we will remember you, for you remember us. Lord, hear our prayer. And may you be honored with the loving response of our hearts. For Jesus' sake. Amen. Friends, our closing praise is Beneath the Cross of Jesus, and our focus is on our great Redeemer. Just as God delivered Noah in the ark, so we have that ultimate deliverance from sin and death and hell in Jesus, and so we're glad to stand beneath his cross and honor him. We bring our praise to God.
Promised hope is found. How great
Friends, we join together in prayer. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all this day and evermore. Amen.